Welcome to a new episode of The Brand Called You. I am Arini and I am with Ashutosh Garg. Today we are continuing our discussion on the journey of a startup. And today we are discussing about how to select a private equity investor. Hello, sir.
Hi, Arini.
So what are the steps one must take before selecting or before going to a private equity investor?
So one of the first steps is to make sure that as an organization, your business is ready to take outside money.
Right.
I think that's the first and most critical step. And a lot of people goof up or fail in this. When I say you should be ready means that number one, your business must be, the business plan must be clear. You should have a team in place. You should have your business plan, which says how do you wish to expand it, your business. And most importantly, you should be very clear on when you get money, how will you deploy that money. So once you've got this clarity, that is when you've got to start thinking about raising money. Because remember that every time you raise more money, well, it makes you feel very good that I'm getting a lot of money, you're bringing in someone else into your business and you're diluting your own shareholding. So therefore, it is important to prepare well before you start thinking about raising money. Once you have decided to raise the money and your management team is in place, then you need two very critical support functions. Number one is you need a lawyer who you can trust completely and who will be able to tell you what is right and wrong. And number two, you need a good investment banker who can understands your business or is willing to understand your business, because your investment banker is the person who will take your story to the many private equity investors who would be interested.
Okay. So once I have decided that I need to go to a private equity investor and I'm ready to dilute my shareholding in the company, when I finally go, should I expect only money from the private equity firm or should I also expect advisory?
So most good private equity firms would be available to help you, because a good private equity firm or a large private equity firm has networks around the world. And therefore, they should be able to draw upon investments they have made in other countries in similar businesses, or they would have access to a much greater resource pool than the Indian entrepreneur would have. So it is always good to get advice from your private equity. And mind you, they will be sitting on your board of directors. So even if you don't want advice as a board member, they will be in their right to give you the advice. But it is good to have a positive relationship with the private equity player. And, you know, getting that relationship is more important, because I have seen dozens of instances when private equity players come into the company and then they start advising and they want to start making changes. And that's when clashes start with the entrepreneur. Because the entrepreneur thinks he or she knows how to run the business, which is true.
Right.
The private equity player says, I've put the money and therefore I have a right to decide how the business should be run. And that is when it becomes important, which I said to you earlier, to have a good investment banker and a good lawyer, because what you write in your agreement when raising private equity will help to determine how the entire relationship with your private equity investor will evolve.
Okay. So once I have a few offers from a few PE firms, how should I go about choosing which one to take?
So, Arini, most people, when they are in the stage of raising money, they are in such a great hurry that they don't read their agreements very carefully. Because for them, getting money into their business is very, very important. What mistake a lot of people do is that they try and grab the first private equity guy who comes to them, and then they don't outline the terms, etc. Mm-hmm. And yet, when the private equity investor is looking at you, they do a very detailed due diligence of your business. They're not going to put 1 rupee into your business because they like your face. They want to do very, very great due diligence of your business. And therefore, it becomes important for you to do a due diligence on the private equity investor.
Okay.
You can ask the private equity, potential private equity partner, to say, tell me which are the places you have invested in, and that I would like to speak to some of the promoters of the companies who have taken your money. Because that will give you an idea of how good or how bad the relationship is between the private equity investor and the promoter.
Okay.
So it is better to go in with your eyes open than to just jump into the fire and then suddenly realize later on that, hey, this is not the kind of partner I wanted,
mm-hmm.
because he's giving me a very, very hard time. He's not letting me function.
Right.
And we have conflicts all the time in the boardroom.
So when I have the agreement, is it okay to negotiate with the people? Or
of
is it
course.
Looked down upon?
No, nothing is looked down upon.
Okay.
It is your business.
Okay.
You're going to give us share in your hard-earned enterprise. And therefore, you have every right to negotiate every little thing. And there's mutuality in it, remember. Your private equity investor is not giving in without negotiation. If you say, I'm going to give 20% of my company for X value, the person will say, but I want 30.
Okay.
So he will start with 30, you will start with 20, you may arrive at an understanding of 25.
Right.
But hidden in the agreements will be lots of conditions of, you know, the technical terms like liquidity preference or ability to claw back some extra shares, or if you are not delivering a certain return that is mentioned there, ability for the private equity guy to raise, you know, to get more shares in your company.
Right.
Because always remember that you know your business, and your private equity investor is in the business of making money.
Right.
So therefore, it is his job to make sure that whatever company or business they invest in, they get the best possible return.
Okay.
So you have to negotiate. They expect you to negotiate. And if you have more than one, then you'll get a sense of where the gap is also.
Okay. So when I negotiate, I would need a lawyer. And most PE firms have the biggest firms on their retainer.
Yeah.
So how do I expect to fight them if I want something? And how do I make them realize?
So I don't think you need to fight the big firms.
Okay.
What you need is a lawyer who you have known, mm-hmm. or who you can get to know, mm-hmm. a lawyer who you can trust. And
right.
I keep saying the word get a lawyer you can trust, because I have not come across any entrepreneur who has the patience or the inclination to read through 500 pages of agreements.
Right.
I certainly did not. And you know, a lot of loopholes do get slipped in because as an entrepreneur, you haven't read through everything.
Right.
So therefore, you need a lawyer who will take this off you, who will say that I am certifying that this agreement is good to sign.
Okay.
Otherwise, you can get into trouble.
Yes, that's good advice. But once the investment goes through, how much influence does a PE firm have over me? Should I let them dictate my growth? Should I let them dictate my operational procedures? And what I, as you correctly said in the beginning, I know my business. I can take advice, but I can't blindly follow them.
Yeah. So again, you will find when an agreement is signed, and I keep going back to the agreement because that is the only governing document that outlines or defines the relationship between you as the promoter and your private equity investor. This agreement will not just specify an investment of X million dollars for X percentage of your company, but it will have a lot of conditions in it, which will include who you can hire, who you can fire as the promoter, how you can use your money, where you can use your money. If a new business has to be looked at, the private equity investor will have a condition that you cannot get into a new business. There will even be conditions which relate to your health. So you will be required to take an insurance policy so that the private equity investors say that, God forbid, if something happens to the promoter, their money is protected because of a big insurance. It's called a key man insurance policy. Mm-hmm. So therefore, a lot of these things are defined very, very clearly. And then, of course, since the private equity investor will have a board member or two members, depending on how much stake they take in your company, the board member has full rights under the law, like you.
Right.
So therefore, as a board member, and remember one thing, that once a board member is appointed, you cannot fire the board member.
Okay.
So therefore, if in the agreement you say that the board member has a life of 3 years and that he or she will retire by rotation, those 3 years, that board member will continue. And if the board member does not resign, there is a very, very complex legal process to remove a board member. So it is critical to define your relationship with your private equity investor in the agreement very carefully. And again, the underlying factor always is that these issues come into play if your business is running into challenges. If your business is flying and there are no issues and the private equity investor can see that, you know, they're going to make a serious amount of money, they will not interfere at all. But if they see that you are not being able to deliver what you had committed to them in the business plan and in the agreement, then you can expect all kinds of corporate governance practices being thrown at you, because they want to protect their money.
As much as it sounds exciting, it sounds scary at the same time.
It is a double-edged sword. I mean, you know, you need external capital to grow. Right. Without it, you cannot grow. And yet at the same time, you have to be cautious about who you bring in into your company as your partner. Because I have seen cases of extremely good investors and I have seen cases of extremely poor investors. And an extremely poor investor destroys the company.
Right. Hopefully that justifies the title of this video, how to select a private equity investor. Because when I started reading the synopsis first, and when you suggested that we should talk about, I was like, oh, do I really need to select a PE firm, or I will just take the money from whoever I get?
Correct.
That's what most entrepreneurs feel. I hope you now feel differently. Hopefully you have been following our other episodes in this journey of a startup. If not, feel free to browse through our YouTube channel. We are on SoundCloud, we are on Spotify, iTunes, everywhere. Just and let us know how you feel. And if you have any questions, please leave them in the comments in any of the channels that you are listening us at. Thank you, and I will see you next week. Thank you for listening to the Brand Called You podcast. Be sure to visit tbcy.in to join the conversation, access show notes, and discover fantastic bonus content. You can follow us on YouTube, Twitter, Facebook, and Instagram. Simply search for The Brand Called You. Thank you, and see you next week.